So specificity in the context of immune system as defined here is a very important aspect. Self non-self discrimination is based on immunology, and how specific a immune response can be actually can described on the basis of Landsteiner's experiments, which were done as early as in 1930, that immune response is very specific, and it is so specific that even subtle molecular differences in a haptin can actually be distinguished by the immune response. You see antibodies raised against aminobenzene do not cross react with any of the other derivatives of this molecule, and vice versa. And these are polyclonal antibodies, and you can see how elegantly this was demonstrated simply by immunizing animals with these small entities, and even small differences between them were so distinctly discriminated by the immune system. To illustrate that in three-dimensional structures, it took almost 50 years. In 1985, there were antibodies, monoclonal antibody against lysozyme, which were crystallized and shown that the specific shape is recognized in the lysozyme molecule. And in fact, this is the complex between the antibody FAB fragment and lysozyme. And as you can see, this is the crystal structure, but you just pull out the two molecules in the computer and you can see shape complementarity between them. So the logic that the specificity is defined in terms of shape and charge complementarity is akin to something like lock and key, and every surface feature of the antigen molecule, you have antibody generated. And at molecular level, what was illustrated by Landsteiner 50 years ago was quite evident. And large number of structures have been determined of antibodies and antigen antibody complexes. And it is generally believed that we understand how the immune system discriminates between different molecules, not only self, non-self, but two different entities. Two different foreign entities can be discriminated. So antibodies generated against one virus will not cross react with another virus, and so on and so forth. So really speaking, much of it seems to be clearly understood and analyzed, and a basic picture can be described by this cartoon little better, because this shape of the molecule becomes an important entity, a molecule or a pathogen if it were to be virus or even for a bacteria. And what is being recognized is by generating antibodies on each part of the surface, which is called as epitope, and you have a lock and key type of logic here. For every surface there is a property. And so in other words, if you go by these crystallographically generated pictures, the physicochemical principles, the complementarity of shape is actually what is utilized in being able to define self non-self discrimination in the immune system. So it seemed to be very well described and clear, except for the fact that the interaction between the immune system and foreign antigens could not be described to be something like a rock-like entity which has a three-dimensional shape and the Y-shaped molecules which are going and decorating it and neutralizing. But there is a dynamics and diversity associated with the host immune system and the pathogens with which this is interacting. So in the disease biology, you have slightly different logic as compared to what crystallographically developed pictures showed you in terms of understanding specificity and describing immune recognition in terms of complementarity and shape and charge. And that is what brought us to think in terms of trying to understand bringing in the dynamics or the wide range of differences that you can see with the immunes, see with the foreign pathogen, would lead to understanding immune response in real world as compared to talking about them as rigid entities. And that is where we started defining it or describing to think in terms of working on the system. The dynamics and diversity, actually one of my students suggested that I should show this picture, that the host pathogen interaction can be best illustrated in terms of what Red Queen tells Alice in the Alice in Wonderland stories, that you have to keep running all the time to be at the same place. And this is true not only for the host but also for the pathogen. Both of them have to keep learning about the intelligence of the opponent to be able to survive for themselves. And this is a beautiful illustration of that. So if we were to treat foreign entities, whether it is viruses or surface molecules and the bacteria, to be rigid rock-like structures, and you generate antibodies, immune system can perfectly take care of all diseases. But if you recognize the fact that there is a mutation possible on the virus surface or a surface protein in the bacteria, or there is structural changes that can take place, then this is what it would stand about. And if you have to illustrate that, or if you have to define this in terms of what the host pathogen interaction would be, then one has to think in terms of what at molecular level you can think about. And we thought about several possibilities that deviate from rock-like structure for antigen and response to that as Y-shaped molecule of the immune system. And one most important thing that comes out now that the human genome sequences are becoming available, as the number of possible entities that have to neutralize the foreign bodies have to be are infinite. In fact, if you just take microbiome, in the universe itself is infinite, but it is not just the existing entities that can be foreign invaders of the host, but also even if you make a synthetic molecule like that haptin that I showed you earlier, or any other short peptide or anything else, if you immunize animals with those, you get antibodies that would cross react. And you have to have then, if the logic of host pathogen interaction is described in terms of rock-like definitive structures as compared to Y-shaped antibodies, then you need infinite number of antibodies. And you, the host genome, which may be probably coding for about 40,000 genes, will not be added. So, you required infinite number of specificities. So, how does the immune system handle this? Second thing is, even if the foreign pathogen is specifically recognized by the immune system, there is no reason to believe that the shape of that foreign entity will remain static, because there is a structural change that is possible, as we understand, for molecular structures of the living systems are. So, even if it is recognized, it can change shape and you have to have a different antibody. Because if you go by the original logic that I had, if shape is to be recognized, change shape is actually a new shape. So, you need new response. And there is another thing, that foreign pathogens always tend to have surface molecules to have some homology with the self molecule. So, if you have a self non-self similarity, then antibodies that are raised against the foreign molecule can cross react with the self molecule, and a good example of that autoimmune disorders. So, you have a cross reactivity there. So, this issue again becomes in the dynamics associated with this possibility, and we actually tried to work on all these aspects by designing experiments using model systems, and we have data for all of them, but I do not think I would confuse you by telling so much, and I will not concentrate on these two aspects, but focus on this aspect of the work that has been done by my students. The redefining that in terms of the model system that we are going to describe to you is exploring the limits of antigenic discrimination would it mean that self-non-self mimicry, how does it manifest in term, while dealing with the foreign entities by the immune system? In other words, what it would mean is ability to discriminate two molecules which may look like similar by the immune system, and structural basis of that is what we decided to discriminate. And we encountered a very simple system. We had come across a system when we decided, and trust me, actually the sequence in which I am talking about it is the sequence in which it has emerged. So just about at that time when we were thinking of this problem, we came across a situation where there is two completely unrelated chemically distinct entities. One is a monosaccharide, monopyranoside, and other is a peptide entity. Both of them seem to bind at the same site on a lectin called concanavalin A, and they compete for binding with comparable affinities. So we thought this is a good starting point for us to think in terms of will these two molecules be mimics of each other, and since they share binding site, they compete for binding to each other, and we can actually present these two molecules, and if these two molecules are mimics of each other structurally, then what follows would be the antibodies raised against one molecule will cross react with other molecule and vice versa. So this was a starting data to believe that these two molecules may be similar. So the immediate next experiment for us to do is to generate antibodies against these two molecules, and this then becomes completely contrary to what we learned from Landsteiner's experiment, which I showed you first, that even small differences in a molecule showed distinct variations in their cross reactivity. Here you have you immunize animals with sugar and it cross reacts with the peptide. If you immunize with peptide, it cross reacts with sugar. So that cross reactivity made us believe that this could happen only if the shapes of these two molecules are similar, otherwise it won't be possible. And we had some ideas why their shapes could be similar. For example, the tyrosines and serines in this peptide have hydroxyl groups, and we thought simplistically those hydroxyl groups could actually be juxtaposed in such a way that they will be the topologies will be similar, and that is what would be recognized. We found this even during the course of maturation, the cross reactivity is valid. So it is not just a cross reactivity as a artifact, but it was evident during the course of immunization, primary as well as secondary antibodies. We also did a experiment of giving sugar first and then giving a booster dose with the peptide and vice versa. Even then we can actually see reactivity taking place. While that was true, it was also very clear that these antibodies cross reacted between sugar and peptide. But if you look at distinguishing between different sugars, you have mannose, glucose and lactose, they discriminate them very nicely, almost the way lectins discriminate between different sugars. There is a very small difference between glucose and mannose, and you could see that. So this is consistent with Landsteiner's experiment. So if we go by that, the sugar and peptide here must be actually topological equivalents. So what we did is we went and determined the structure of the peptide and also sugar, which was determined by earlier, and this is the three-dimensional structure of sugar bound to concanavalin A. The setback we had was the peptide bound at some place else other than the sugar, and that didn't allow us to see that the interaction of the peptide and the interaction of the sugar to be compared, and that was sort of a disappointing thing. And we tried actually to do this experiment little more in the computer to take these two molecules, because we had a structure in the bound form, and see if there is a topological relationship between the two. And we were not able to do this. So this disappointment led us to think about what is the relationship between two molecules which may be functionally mimics of each other. So we it so happened that we came across another system where there is a porphyrin molecule also seems to bind to concanavalin A, And a friend of mine had done extensive experiments to show porphyrin also binds to concanavalinase, so does the sugar. So we did a crystal structure of porphyrin bound to concanavalin A, and that showed a very nice relationship. We could see part of the porphyrin moiety sits exactly where the concanavalin A binds. And not only that, if you look at the details of the molecular interactions, particularly hydrogen bonding, they really fit very well in what this sulfonate, phenyl sulfonate group does is adopts couple of water molecules from solvent, and this is a very high resolution structure. So the images are very clear. You can see the hydrogen bonding matching in both of them. So topological relationship between two entities which are otherwise chemically distinct was very nicely illustrated in this. But we were not able to show that in case of sugar and peptide. We did do few more of these experiments. One thing is very clear that the porphyrin binds in the sugar binding site in not only one lectin but other two lectins also, except that the interactions were described. And this is one first indication that we thought there is a way that there are more than way, one ways in which the ligand receptor interaction can take place. So what we had here was an interesting relationship, and one of the issues that arose from this porphyrin binding to concanavalin A or jacqueline or peanut agglutinin in three different ways, although binding to concanavalin A resembled that of binding by sugar, there was differences between them. And in this is a side story that I will briefly tell you, but move on to come to mimicry. Interesting observations that we had of packing up molecules in the crystals of a complex between porphyrin and lectins. And that packing seems to have some insight in terms of molecular pathology of the disease called porphyria. Porphyria is a genetic disorder that involves alterations in heme biosynthesis resulting in accumulation of porphyrins. And what we saw in the structure is if this you take as a concanavalin A molecule and the binding site for porphyrin as well as sugar is on the tip. This seems to be porphyrin concanavalin A binding to be facilitating cross-linking in the crystal formation. That was true also in case of jacqueline and porphyrin, except that the mode of interactions was different. It was as evident between the peanut agglutinin and this porphyrin, except that here you have even more porphyrins binding. But what it meant is the accumulated porphyrins inside the cell may be cross-linking the glycoproteins like lectins in a similar way to what probably is happening in the crystal structures. And this is corroborating with the fact that in porphyria, one of the practiced therapies which works is administration of glucose. So competition and displacement of porphyrins could be. This is our hypothesis. We really thought we need to do experiments further to do it, but that is for another occasion. What it tells us so far, what I have told you is mimicry between sugar and porphyrin on one hand, where we demonstrated concanavalin A interactions, concanavalin A is a receptor, with porphyrin and sugar is truly mimic at topological level. But sugar and peptide doesn't show any structural correlation. And we thought while immune system treats them to be equivalent, so there is a functional mimicry between sugar and peptide, but there is no topological relationship between them. So if we really want to understand further in terms of this functional mimicry which we saw in the immune system, then there is no point in going to concanavalin A as a receptor, because we are not talking about functionality at the looking at the plant protein, but we really need to treat this functionality more in terms of antibodies. And you cannot do molecular description or understand molecular description by analyzing polyclonal antibodies. All that you can do is ELISA and show whether they cross react or they don't cross react. So in order to analyze this at molecular level, you really need to get natural receptors to be linked with the immune system, and the only way you can do is to make monoclonal antibodies. So my students went ahead and made large number of monoclonal antibodies against the peptide as well as sugar, and here I have a summary of the cross reactivity of the close to a dozen monoclonal antibodies, and it was quite interesting that half of the clones that were made bound very specifically to sugar. They did not cross react with the peptide, but the other half, in fact slightly more than half we can see, cross reacted with sugar and peptide. So it was first evidence that we had that treating sugar and peptide to be similar by the immune system could be deciphered at molecular level at two distinct levels. There is one level at which the fidelity of the immune system being treating the entity to be a distinct chemical entity with distinct topology is very clearly available, but there is other one treated them to be separate. So what we really needed to do here is to try and look at one antibody which is cross reactive in between sugar and peptide, and look at another antibody which is distinguishing the sugar. So we did characterize these two antibodies, and it was quite clear. In fact, we measured the affinities as well, and it was quite clear that 2D10 cross reacts with sugar and peptide with comparable affinities. This is very good behavior in terms of similarity to polyclonal response. But 1H7 recognized only mannose and not the peptide. This data we generated even for anti-peptide antibodies, but I don't think we need to show too much. This is suffice. It is very interesting, even the monoclonal antibody 1H7 was able to discriminate very well between different sugars. It binds poorly with methyl glucuronosamide and lactose and binds better. But the 2D10, the one monoclonal, which actually did not distinguish between them. So there is a plastic behavior here. We did a thermodynamic experiment by comparing these two, and that gave us some clues of the behavior. It was quite evident if you increase the temperature, 1H7 remained tightly bound to the sugar moiety, even the primary antigen against which it was. But the 2D10 actually released off the sugar very quickly. The free energy of binding increased, decreased substantially when you increase the temperature. And that provided a key to believe that behavior of binding of one which has only sugar binding is pre-designed and tight, but the behavior of binding to the second antibody seems to be thermodynamically determined to be such that you increase the temperature and it becomes a loose fit. So we essentially had a logical example of an antibody 2D10 which bound to sugar and peptide with comparable affinity, and thermodynamics indicated the binding behavior of this is different from the binding behavior of sugar antibody which did not cross react with the peptide. So the next thing for us to do is assume originally, as I described to you, that the antigens have similar topologies, but we had sort of compared the bound structures to the other receptor, and this doesn't seem to be giving us any ideas about topologies being similar. So there could be other possibilities that rather than shapes of the two ligands becoming similar, the antibody actually adopts different structures while binding to these two antigens. So, we decided that we will test that out by now crystallizing this antibody bound to the sugar and peptide, and unlike in case of concanavalin A, in this case it ought to be binding at the same site because they were generated by ensuring that antigen combining site is the binding site. By this time actually while in the course of time we actually lost this antibody. So, that became another setback, but not to be let down by not having the antibody. We realized that we had before the we lost the clone, we had actually sequenced the antibody. So, we had the sequence of this antibody, but we did not have the hybridoma. So, what my students did was to make recombinantly a single chain antibody with the sequence of the 2D10 and were able to make purified antibody from the inclusion bodies, and 2D10 behaved exactly like the naturally made, well not naturally, hybridoma made antibody and bound very similarly, and then we could see that the we were able to get crystals of 2D10 antibody, and not only got crystals of the antibody but also got crystals bound to sugar and peptide. So, my students determined the structures of the native 2D10 antibody bound to sugar and bound to peptide, and that now allowed us to compare whether the topologies of sugar and peptide are similar or topologies of the antibody keeps changing. And it was quite evident that the structure of the antibody while binding to sugar, peptide are practically identical in the three cases. The antibody did not check. So, neither was the two ligands showing similar structure. It was also true that major part of the interaction of the peptide is in the sugar binding site, and so there is a substantial overlap between the two. It was also quite evident that the sugar binding topology, if you can see that there are these tyrosines and these tyrosines, there is this another tyrosines. So, there is geometry of the binding site of the antibody is identical in the two cases, and it was quite clear that the sugar and peptide do not have same structure. So, what we had here is structures are different, but the interactions are different in the two cases. The binding modes, unlike what I showed you in case of porphyrin sugar, we could see hydrogen bonding was similar. Here you cannot even say hydrogen bonding is similar. So, the topological relationship between the two molecules, two antigens does not exist. The interactions with the antibodies also does not exist. So, we have demonstrated clearly structures of the antibody are similar, structures of the two antigens are very different, yet they bind at the same site and interact. So, what we saw here so far by making the monoclonal antibodies against the sugar and peptide, that there is a set of clones which would acquire the ability to discriminate, ensuring the specificity and fidelity, that is like that 1H7 kind of antibody, and there are series of those antibodies which are possible to make. So, specificity is possible to maintain in antibody clones that are generated against a given antigen. But you do have a set of clones which actually have a plasticity. Plasticity possible even if the structures are not the issue, but in terms of interaction. And this probably is designed to disregard antigenic variations. What I am trying to say is this plasticity that we are observing in sugar peptide mimicry is not necessarily a one-off artifact, but you can actually go back and see you do have antibodies reported which cross react. And there are plenty of cross reactivities when you generate polyclonal antibody, but there are even monoclonal antibodies that are generated against one antigen do cross react with others. So, having gone through this first, we then looked at possible literature, and we do see that this is not something as a one-off phenomenon, but there is a cross-reactivity, and that may be designed into the immune response to have a certain set of antibody clones that are actually cross-reacting with each other. So that gives us a dichotomy in terms of you have polyreactive antibodies that are produced by the immune system, and as I described in the last slide, that may help the host to have an edge in the battle with the pathogen. It actually explains very nicely what if you have a wide range of possible variations in the immune response, you could cover for hotspots of mutations. If there is a virus that is mutating, it would actually be able to take care of it by having few antibodies which are slightly different, and even if there is a mutation, it would still recognize to be equivalent, and that would be really intelligence on the part of the immune system. But then you do have intelligence on the part of the pathogens as well. You have well-known examples of immune evasion by influenza virus or human immunodeficiency virus. There are specific hotspots of mutation which still escape. And this dichotomy is quite evident if you compare the data that we know very well in terms of immune evasion by the pathogens, and I described to you data which is contrary, and this essentially this picture beautifully highlights how on one hand you have pathogens that are really intelligent to overcome the ability of the immune system to take care or neutralize them, and on the you have immune system, it actually shows at least even simply at molecular level in terms of specificity to be able to overcome the problems. So this brought us to hit the problem head on and think in terms of what to do next. And since everything that I described to you with innocuous sugar and peptide molecule, we went all the way by looking at Landsteiner type of experiment and generating antibodies which showed cross reactivity, and molecularly described that to ensure thermodynamically, structurally, they are indeed cross reacting, and analyze at structural level where the description of these two properties are, and all through this we had no violation of rules of physics and chemistry. It was quite overwhelming to see that a same structure of the binding site interacting with two distinct molecules without changing structure, with different type of topologies, with similar affinity, and yet that does not violate any physical principles of specificity, because you could have a different set of hydrogen bonding interactions in the same site, and that makes this experiment to be done little more on the real life kind of system. So we thought next we should do is to go and look at the specificity and degeneracy of antibodies against the neutralizing epitopes of the viruses that are known to evade immune response. So what I'm actually covering here is to start from a issue that arises from dynamics and diversity associated to immune system, take the model system and illustrate how there is a subtle differences in terms of initial logic of complementarity of shape and charge. In other words, structure based functional description that one could think in terms of crystallography. You could actually design crystallographic and thermodynamic experiments to illustrate that specificity could be modulated by plasticity, and this can be adopted intelligently for the given purpose. And this is the one which connects to my title, in the sense what I showed you in immune system antibody being able to bind to more than one molecules. This actually can happen in case of even enzymes, where as a binding site of an enzyme can be adopted for more than one functions. And you can actually address this issue in terms of if you have one molecule multiple functions, it can really very well happen without violating the structural biology or laws of physics and chemistry. And what is true for immune system would be true for many other physiological aspects at molecular level, where receptor and ligand interaction becomes a key for specificity. And what I described to you is work in progress, and hopefully in future occasions I'll be able to show you interesting data when how these adoptions could take place in epitopes which are arising from viruses which are otherwise supposed to have hotspots of mutation. I have actually listed everything that who has worked with me in the past, and thank you for your attention.